So I have a patient who I'm worried about an ovarian torsion. Okay, they came in with sharp pain on the pelvis. You know, there's severe thriving in pain. Obviously, we order an ultrasound. Now the ultrasound showed blood flow, but I'm still very suspicious. What do you think?
Well, one of the things that I would always want to do is, take a careful history, because many of these patients will have a history of intermittent episodes of pain that will spontaneously resolve, sometimes over 1 to 2 weeks prior to the final torsion that doesn't untwist.
Okay.
So, by the time you get to the point where there's no blood flow on the ultrasound, a lot of times those adnexa are necrotic, and all you can do is take out the ovary.
Mm-hmm. So, are there any ultrasound findings of subtle that would kind of tell us that maybe was torsed and detorsed?
Nothing specifically. I'll tell you, some of the signs that are particularly worrisome are size. If the ovary is more than 5 or 6 centimeters in size, that's a bad sign, because that means that it's already become so edematous from venous compression that it's reaching its limit of how much it can stand. And another thing that is moderately concerning is when there's free pelvic fluid surrounding the ovary.
Any free pelvic fluid? Or?
Well, I mean, more than just a small sliver of fluid on the ultrasound. If you see a few centimeters of fluid pocket on an ultrasound, along with a good history of pain, that's very concerning. I don't know that I'd want to leave that unoperated on.
Okay, so let's say I was right, and the ultrasound comes positive for torsion. What does that mean? What are they seeing on the ultrasound?
Well, what they're seeing typically is they do a Doppler vascular flow study on the ovary, which with color ultrasound can show you pulsatile flow. And if there's absence of pulsatile flow, you know that not only the first thing that compresses is the venous outflow, but then when the arterial inflow becomes compressed, then there's no flow.
No flow at all.
No flow at all.
So you could actually see some flow but non-pulsatile and think that maybe there's early torsion?
It's possible. That's a hard call to make, unless you're a really experienced sonographer or just really specialized in GYN ultrasound.
What's this thing when they say complex ovarian mass and then you think, well, this is a torsion then?
Well, the majority of masses that are heavy enough to undergo torsion will usually be complex insofar as there'll be a hemorrhagic cyst or, not uncommonly, a dermoid, which tends to be filled with much more dense material. The bigger, heavier, more complex cysts, mucinous cyst adenomas, things like that, that weigh more, they will stretch the pedicle of the ovary and allow too long of a leash, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And so dermoids, hemorrhagic cysts, endometriomas, those are more common to twist than to just a simple unilocular cyst filled with nothing but simple clear fluid.
Okay. So let's say you decide to take him to the OR. There's a torsion. You took him to the OR. And when you get there, what makes you decide to take the ovary or not? What are you looking for?
Just visual evidence of necrosis, where you can tell a lot of times when you just handle the ovary, even if you handle it very, very gently, if it starts to peel apart and the surface becomes fragmented with even atraumatic instruments trying to lift it, that's a sign that's been going on too long and the tissue is just breaking down.
Okay. So are torsions like more common to happen than on the other ovary? I mean, is this a familiar thing or is it just random?
It's a random thing, and in my 20-something years of doing this, I don't think I've ever seen a patient with recurrent torsion in an opposite ovary.
Other than sheer bad luck or
something. Yeah, the worst luck you can imagine.